Do you really want God to speak to you? Like, do you? Yay, nay, anyone? Okay. Yes? Yes, yes, yes. Okay. He's about to. Here's your Bible, right? There's the Bible. He spoke, and there it is, okay? So many of the sections of the scripture that we'll read together will be up on the screen. Not all of them, but most of them. We're going to start there in Romans chapter 7, and it's going to be verses 14 through 25. Like, that's the main thing, but we'll be jumping all over. I'm going to jump all over. And so we'll be in Leviticus, we'll be in Exodus, we'll be in Galatians, we'll be in Ephesians, we'll be in Hebrews, we'll be all over the place. So, but Romans 7 is really the main thing. So as you're turning there, I was just thinking, one of the weird things about Christianity, I don't know what it is with this culture that we live in America, but we have a broken world, you know what I mean? We have a broken world, it's all messed up. And one of the things, there's lots of evidence for that, right? You can just look, you can put the TV on, you see it. I mean, it's messed up. And I got some examples. But one of the things I've noticed is that this world, no matter how nasty and rotten people can be, they've come up with this idea that Christian equals perfect. Like, that's what you're supposed to be. You're supposed to be perfect. Like, but it's a broken world, so this whole idea that Christians are supposed to be perfect, and listen, Christians don't say that. Christians don't usually say that, but the people that are not believers, they've set this bar for us because they know we're going to fail it, right? They know we're going to fail and drop way below the bar, right? And so then they can sit there and they can, you know, they've got their mouth on a crack pipe and they're cheating on their spouse, but they're in the car with the wife that they're having an affair on, and they see a Christian kind of get into their parking space a little bit before they do with their Z88 sticker on. They go, "See, honey, they're all the same." Hypocrites, right? You see that all the time, right? They're rotten, you know, the little white lie, and they're just, oh, so bad. We're not supposed to be perfect. Like, no doubt that the Bible says that there's, you know, fly high, Christians. Let's just melt it down and fly high. There's a higher standard for us and we're supposed to live up to. But nowhere, it doesn't say that you're going to be perfect. Like, not this side of glory. You're not going to be perfect, right? Not going to be perfect, but it's what you're supposed to shoot for. Shoot for it. And as in your pursuit of perfection, you're going to get more and more like Jesus. I get that. But this whole idea of perfection equals Christian equals perfection, it's out of a broken system from broken people. I mean, when I say broken, I'm not talking about like the stuff that you see on TV, like all the stuff that's going on now, like people are getting beheaded and there's wars. I mean, like just insane, crazy stuff on TV. You see it all the time, right? Well, I don't have cable, but that's what I hear. Right? But I'm not talking about big stuff like that. I'm talking about little stuff. Like in your own little world, you know that the world is broken. Like just the other day, so here's the thing. Like my babies, they don't like to sleep. And so they just keep waking up. Oh, by the way, they're having a girl. Just in case you guys didn't know that, yeah. So, another baby. It's going to be awesome. So it's gonna be awesome, right? Yeah. What little hair you have. I mean, it's gonna be great. So my babies, they don't just sleep. But Meredith, God bless her heart, she gets up with them all the time. She's just really good to me. She doesn't make me get up, but she knows the reason why she doesn't make me get up is because she knows, unlike her, if I get up, I don't go back to sleep. I don't have that talent. I'm one of those guys you see on Facebook and you're like, that guy is weird. The guy who posts, still up, sleep, where are you? You know that guy, right? I'm that guy, right? So I wake up at 3:30 in the morning and I don't even remember which baby woke up. One of them woke up, and then of course, when one's up, the other one's like, well, I guess it's party time. So let's just get up. This is what you have coming. So let's get up and let's play, right? So I'm now up because now she can't handle the both of them at once, you know, because she usually does shifts. You take one, you run into the other room, and, you know, but here, Bailey and Blair are at the house, so there's no place to run. So it's just you're in your bedroom and you try to comfort one, it wakes up the other, now it's on. It's on. And so this is how I know that the world is broken, because when I walk, finally I get up, I walk into the living room, I can't sleep. I'm like, all right, I'll go into the kitchen. I'll get a glass of milk, supposedly nice warm milk, right? It's supposed to help you sleep. That's the rumor, right? So we can Google it. So I'm going to go into the kitchen. I'm going to get a glass of milk, and I'm still kind of groggy, so I'm thinking maybe I'll have a glass of milk, and then I'll just go right back to sleep, please. So I walk in. Now, in our living room, right by, you know, living room into kitchen, we have this clock on the wall. Some of you have seen it. Kind of scary. But it's this there. Dead guy gave it to me, so I'm going to keep it. And so there's a little sensor on it, light sensor. It only goes off at night because, I mean, it only goes off during the day because at night it doesn't want to make noise and stuff like that. So I walk out, and I'm not thinking, and the second, it's 3:46, I think it was, but our clock is 10 minutes fast. It's jacked. It's an hour and 10 minutes fast. I'm so lazy, it's ridiculous. It's still there, and I've gotten used to it. I don't know. So as soon as I walk into the kitchen, I'm like, I'm going to get this glass of milk, and the second I turn the light on, we're on top of the world, looking down on creation. It's like a symphony. And I'm just like so mad that this happened. Like it could, right? And that's all I could think of was with these words, this world is broken. I'm sorry, but I was pissed. I mean, I was just so mad over the stupid clock, you know? Right down, now today, here's another one. Today, you know this world is so broken. So I'm driving around all day. My mom's sister's husband passed away, right? He died last Friday. So my mom had to come down to comfort her and all that stuff. So we had to go to the airport, pick her up, take her to Deltona, all that kind of crazy stuff, right? And people never die at the right time. I don't know what their problem is. But they just, you know, I'm busy. You know what I'm saying? I'm busy. I can't be bothered with this kind of stuff, right? So, but anyway, I'm driving around. So we got to drive to the airport, Deltona, back and forth. It's just insanity. So here's the thing. Like, you guys know that it's legal to drive golf carts into Tavares, city limits. You know that, right? Okay. You got it. So I'm driving down Dead River Road. I'm running behind, you know, got church coming. There's the pressure of that stress, you know, I got to talk in front, you know, the whole thing. And I'm going down Dead River, and there's two golf carts, like chips. Like, what is that? They're driving down the road side by side. Why don't you just freaking hold hands, dude? I mean, seriously, they're going down the road, right? And there's seven cars behind me down Dead River, and I'm in a rush. I got to get to my kid's house. You know, I mean, it's just crazy. I got to get back in time. I got to go to the airport, the whole nine yards. I got to get back here. And there's two golf carts, right? So the one guy looks back. He sees it. And so he hits a hard right, goes down the sidewalk. I'm like, amen. Amen. The guy in the other golf cart, right? This guy's got hoopty golf cart. He's got huge batteries hooked up and a big speaker box on it. Speakers in the dash, like, you know, like, okay. He's enjoying his DUI. Let's just put it that way, okay? He's enjoying his DUI, and so he's got a Mac Daddy golf cart, and he's driving on the road, right? And this is a big, burly dude in tank top, not an inch of skin left, covered in ink, you know, just rough and tumble guy, and he's driving down the road like this with his arm on the seat, and he looks, the other guy took off, God bless him, he's going to heaven, and so this guy here, he looks back, right, he looks at us and just keeps driving. I wanted to punch him in the face, honest to goodness. I mean, I'm just being honest with you, right? You want to punch him right now. Jared wants to punch him right now, right? He wouldn't move out of the way. And this is before, like, if you know Dead River where I live, I ran into him at the cemetery, and he did this all the way to the freaking gas station. I wanted to fight him. I'm just being honest with you. I wanted to fight him. He would have murdered me, but I wanted to punch him anyway. It was humongous. It was like me taking on Joey over here, right? But I wanted to. But I know the world is broken. It's absolutely broken. Now, out of this broken world, people get this assumption. I displayed that I'm not right then in my car because I wanted to hurt him, right? But there's a need for Jesus alone. You can't just get saved. You know, we talked about this last week. I touched on this, but I want to dive into a little bit more. This ongoing need for the gospel. You know what I'm saying? Like, I needed Jesus in the car. Now, you know, Jesus take the wheel. And it wasn't so I could get out and punch him. It was Jesus take the wheel and take over the wheel of my life. You know what I mean? Like, I needed the gospel right then and there, you know? Because I'm the guy in the golf cart to Jesus, and I wouldn't get out his way, but he loves me anyway. Let me ask you all a question. That's all funny and everything, but you know when you go to a wedding and you see on the tables the little name tags? This is where you sit, this is where you sit. You get your little name assignments. Do you know what I'm talking about? Yeah, who would agree that at the end of the Bible, it talks about the lamb having, you know, Jesus is going to have this wedding supper, like when all of his believers are going to get around the table for this big old feast, you know what I mean, the wedding supper of the lamb. Who agrees that the Apostle Paul, who wrote half of the New Testament, right, planted churches, appointed elders, greatest preacher, evangelist that ever lived, who would agree that in heaven somewhere, like Jesus had him preparing a place, he's going to come back and get some folks, you know what I mean? Like, who would agree that somewhere, like probably at the head table, Paul's got a little card with his name on it? Would you all, anybody, other than two people? I know you're fired, you can raise your hand, okay? If you're going to raise your hand, let's just raise your hand. You know what I'm saying? Don't just go, you know, like a raptor, you know what I'm saying? Like a velociraptor, yeah. Who thinks so? Me. Okay, so if we agree, right, that Paul's going to be in glory, he's going to be sitting there with Jesus, right? Now, this is the same Paul that said in 1 Corinthians to follow me as I follow Christ, right? Follow me as I follow Christ. This is the example of the Christian that we're supposed to follow him, emulate who this guy is. He's going to be like Jesus, and so be like him. He says, follow me, be my disciple, if you will. So if Christian is supposed to be perfect, we know that it's a broken system, because when we look at the life of Paul here in Romans chapter 7, you're going to see something. You're like, Christian doesn't mean perfect. Christian does not mean perfect. I want to read something with you here. Romans chapter 7. Verse 14, I'm going to read on through, 25? Let's read that. You guys got your Bibles there? All right, so here we are. So Paul says this to these folks in Rome. He says, so the trouble, he was talking about the law of God, and then we've argued about that, you know, what it's for and all that kind of good stuff. We can go back there if you want some Sunday night. But he says, so the trouble is not with the law. He's talking about God's law, not some, you know, law of the nations. So the trouble is not with the law, for it is spiritual and good. The trouble is with me, for I am all too human, a slave to sin. Kind of uses those terms together, like if you're human, that means that's what you are. I don't really understand myself. Anyone guilty of that? Anyone ever say, like, what in the world did I just do? What in the, right? Like, are you kidding me? Did I just, don't be hitting him, okay? Hit yourself. Amen. That was a good amen spot. Yeah.
That would be asking, what did I just do?
That's okay. So I don't really understand myself. Now, this is crazy. This is Paul, the guy who wrote the Bible, right? And he's going, I don't get it. I don't understand myself. For I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Anyone? Raise your hand. Like, here's the thing, right? Okay, we're all in this. Right? This is a text. For I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. I understand. Instead, I do what I hate. This will be fun. Every time you see something that's you, raise your hand, okay? Instead, I do what I hate. But if I know that what I am doing is wrong, this shows that I agree that the law is good. So I am not the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. And I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature. I want to do what is right, but I can't. Come on. I want to do what is good, but I don't. Come on, right? I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. It's tiresome in here, right? No raptor arms, Dan. Full extension here. Right? Can't hide. I am not really the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart, but there is another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? Show your hands. Thank God the answer is in Jesus Christ our Lord. So you see how it is. In my mind, I really want to obey God's law, but because of my sinful nature, I am a slave to sin. Okay, so we all identify. Yeah, Ryan's like, yeah, feet, you know. Pick up a chair. So we all agree that this is like us. Right? We could have wrote this. Like, we don't need Paul to write this. We could have wrote our own little New Testament over here. This is the story of our lives, right? And so I'm reading this, and there's a verse in Scripture, and it's in Romans, too, that's always spoke very loudly to me. And that's one of the reasons why, like, of all the things that God is, like, I love the Bible. I'm into the Bible, you know what I mean? And Romans 15:4, it says that the Scriptures give us hope and encouragement as we wait patiently for God's promises to be fulfilled. Like, I love that, because that's the reason why we would study the Scriptures, right? To give us hope and encouragement. But I'm reading this, and I'm going, really? How can that be encouraged? The guy who wrote the Bible's a total bust? Like, that's encouraging? That's going to give me hope? Well, I kind of think, after I was thinking about it for a while, I kind of think that it does, because I think more of us would be like him, right? I think more of us would be more like Paul than perfect. Would you agree? So do you agree? Yes, okay. So here's the thing. You all agreed that there's a ticket on the table in heaven with his name on it. He's definitely going. Right? And he's a total bust. So if he's a total bust and he's going, what's this say? You got some hope. Be encouraged. You bust. Be encouraged. Be encouraged. All right? So we're talking about gospel continuation here the last couple of weeks, because it was not just a matter of getting saved. You know, you hear the Romans road, you're a sinner, you're terrible, you need Jesus, or you're going to go to hell and burn and all that kind of good stuff, you know? So there's more than that, though, right? So we're talking about how we need the gospel to continue on in our lives day to day. And when you read this about Paul, that's what he's talking about. Like, I'm faced with choices every day, and inevitably, I do the wrong thing. Like, I want to do this, but I don't. I don't want to do this, but I do. Who's going to save me? Himself? More education? A better hobby? And he's like, no, what's going to save me is Jesus Christ the Lord. Just like he saved me when I got to my knees and said, I need you for salvation. Same thing. He's not talking about salvation to glory. He's talking about day-to-day choices, the things that he wants to do. He still needs saving. That's the power of God, the gospel. Remember Romans chapter 1, that the gospel is the power of God saving, present tense, everyone who believes. Same thing today, saving. So when you talk about the gospel and talk about continuation, most of the time, people aren't talking about continuation. They're talking about just the gospel itself to save somebody. Romans 3:25, that Jesus is a sacrifice for sin. We get that. Romans 8:4, same thing. He's talking about Jesus was the sacrifice for our sins. And it goes on to tell us that God did this, put his son up on the cross, so that the just requirement of the law would be fully satisfied for us. So we talk about that. That's like the famous part of the gospel. The gospel that saves us from hell and puts us in that undeserved place in the heavenly realms with Jesus to rule and reign someday with him when he takes over the joint. We get that, right? But there's more to it than that. There's way more to it than that. That's kind of what we're going to jump into tonight. But before we do that, I want to talk about this just requirement of the law, this salvation. The salvation is of God. It's not of you. You can't earn it. You didn't even ask for it. You got it because he loves you. So that's a good deal, right? That's a good deal. The just requirement. Talk about the requirement of the law for a second. We talked about this before. There's two requirements to the law. And I want to clarify what he's talking about here tonight. There's two requirements. One, you got to keep them. That's a requirement, right? All 613 laws, keep them. That's a tough call. No one's ever done it, except one. They killed him. Okay, so it's tough. It's a tough call. You got to keep the law. Man, I like that T-shirt. Look at Eddie sporting that cotton, buddy. Woo! Looking sharp, buddy. Looking sharp. Okay, no applause for that? Seriously, you guys are pathetic. Eddie, you look good, man. He's like, I know. So there's two requirements of the law. One, you got to keep it. All 613 laws, you got to keep them, right? That's one requirement. The second one is that you got to do when you break it. And see, this is what he's talking about here. This sacrifice for sin doesn't mean it's like, okay, worship is over, you can kind of do what you want. No. Saying the just requirement doesn't talk so much about keeping the law or following God or worshiping him well. It doesn't talk about that. Right here, he's talking about the just requirement, the justice system. What does that mean? You do something wrong, you got to pay the piper, right? The justice system in our country kind of works that way, supposedly. You do something wrong, wrong, whether it's jail time, probation, fees, whatever it is, you have to pay your debt to society for what you did, right? That's the way it's supposed to be. And so it's the same thing. Like, and you don't, how many people in here, don't show hands, but how many people in here agree with capital punishment, right? Some people do, some people don't. But the law of the land prevails. Whether you like it or not, there is a just requirement of our laws in the United States of America, and then state by state as well. And whether you agree with it or not, you have to deal with it. Why? Because you didn't decide that law. The government decides it. They make a decision, you got to live under it. You're part of this country, so you live under it. So justice doesn't always look pretty, does it? It doesn't always look pretty, but God is justice. Do you understand this? God is justice. And so if he makes a rule and says there's a justice requirement of the law, it may not be pretty, but you have to live under it. And so the just requirement of the law, we see it in Hebrews 9:22. It says that without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sin. Now, if I was God, I might not choose that route. If you were God, you might not choose that route. But that's the route that the God of justice, who is justice, he decided that. That you have something, when someone breaks his rules, the payment of that is something has to bleed. Okay, that's a tough one, would you admit? That's a tough one, but he's God, right? And so you have to live with it. Now, let's look at Old Testament scripture. I read this, it's an awesome verse, man. You got to hear this. This is incredible. It oozes with messianic prophecy, and I've never heard anyone really talk about it. They may have. I'm not the first one to stumble upon this, but you got to read this. This is awesome. Leviticus 17:11, talking about the whole idea of bleeding for the forgiveness of sin, right? It says this. This is God speaking in Leviticus. This is way back, like before any person had ever even thought about Jesus, right? I know God's got this plan, but people that are walking on earth, they're not thinking about that, right? And this is what it says in Leviticus 17:11. It says, for the life of the flesh is in the blood. Would you agree with that, right? We need that to live. Anyone ever have all their blood drained out and live? Okay, no. So you need that blood. So the life of the flesh is in the blood. And God says, and I, God, have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. Now, I looked at that Bible, and I've never seen God on the altar bleeding prior to Jesus. I've never seen that before, right? And it's just this little glimpse into the future that he is going to put his own blood on the altar for the forgiveness of your sin to atone for your souls. It was oozing with messianic prophecy. It was amazing. As a matter of fact, you see over also in Exodus 24:8, this is kind of disgusting. I'm not going to lie to you. It talks about Moses. And they get all these animals, and they're slaughtering all these animals for sacrifices, and they need the blood for forgiveness and all that stuff. And it said that Moses, in 24:8, Moses sprinkled the blood of the animals on the people. Yeah, ew, right? Disgusting, right? He sprinkled the blood on the people to confirm the covenant between the Lord and his people. That's totally disgusting, right? I mean, it was a bloody mess back then. You guys realize this? It wasn't just like one little chicken. I mean, they were killing stuff left and right, and there's blood all over the place, and they're sprinkling it all over the people just to confirm this covenant. So really what you see, this whole blood sacrifice really had a twofold ministry, if you will. One was to forgive you of your sin, that atonement, right? You did wrong, you got to pay for it. That's what the blood was for. And of course, we're going to see that Jesus Christ, the man, the Son of God, the God-man, giving his own blood upon the altar for the saving of your souls. That's amazing. But it also has this other ministry of this covenant between God and his people. And it's this same covenant back then, really, as it is now. He said that he will provide for you. You know, seek for the Father already knows all your needs. And seek first his kingdom and his righteousness and all these things that you need. They'll be added unto you, right? He said that. He would provide for us. He said he would protect us. God says he's an ever-present help in time of trouble. That's God's words. That's his promise. That's his covenant. He also says that he will be with you. All through the scripture, several times it says, and listen, I will never leave you nor forsake you. In the Great Commission, what does Jesus say? Go for it, make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And remember this, I'll be with you even to the end of the age. This is the promises of God. This is the covenant. And so that blood, whether it was on the altar back then or whether it's Jesus' blood now, it's that covenant. That's his promises to his people right now. So was it bloody and disgusting? Yes. Only one person thinks it's gross. I think it's gross. That's two. Totally disgusting. But the question is it just? Whether you think it's, we wouldn't maybe not have chose that, like that wouldn't be your way maybe to bloody up everything and sprinkle blood all over people. Maybe it wouldn't be my way to choose the most perfect, beautiful person that ever lived and whip them to death and put them on a cross so they would bleed and die. Like it might not be my choice, but it's justice. It's the just requirement of God for his law. Do you understand? Do you understand? Okay. So the just requirement of the law is that the penalty of our rebellion, both passive and active, remember passive, it's just passed down in through the DNA into who you are. You're a sinner at the moment that your mom conceived you. Psalm 51, that's what David said. I was born, conceived a sinner in iniquity. That's what he said. But it also pays for the penalty of your active rebellion, the times you choose to sin and not follow God. So the penalty for all these things has been paid in full, once and for all, in Christ. That's an amen spot, okay? So here's the thing. We're guilty. All of us are guilty. I think it was Romans 3:19. We're all guilty before God. And that's part of the gospel. We're all guilty, but according to this, Jesus pays in full and covers fully satisfies the just requirement of the law to pay for your sin, all of them, and to provide that thing forever, that covenant. That this is what I promised you guys. I'm going to protect you. I'm going to provide for you. I'm going to be with you forever. That's the covenant that he makes with us. And so even though we're guilty, he makes this covenant with us and he pays it in full. But God tells us that really us being guilty was like the least of your problems. Being guilty was the least of your problems. In Colossians, it tells us that not only are you guilty, but you're his enemy. You're an enemy of God. Before you bend the knee to Jesus, you're an enemy of God, trying to claim things that are not your doing. You know, that's just his way against my way. You know, this is my creation, worship me. And you're like, no, I want to worship what you made. I want to thank you for what you've given me. I just want to enjoy what you've given me. I don't want to give you credit for nothing. And so we're fighting and fighting and fighting, and God all the while is trying to seriously destroy you and establish himself in you as the Lord of your life instead of yourself because you don't make a very good God. And so he's trying to do that. But it gets even worse. So not only are you guilty and you're his enemy, but this same Paul who said those two things, he also says something to the church in Ephesus that makes it even worse. Go to Ephesus chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. Yeah, Ephesus chapter 2. Like you guys got it right. I don't want to ask you how many people read your Bible today. Don't even. All right, Ephesus chapter 2, Ephesians chapter 2, 1 through 9. Let's hear what this guy has to say to all of us here, right? This is a church that was rocking too. If you read in Revelation, they had it going on. It says this, Ephesians 2, 1, once you were dead. See, before he says you were guilty, that's bad. Then he says you're an enemy of God because of your evil thoughts and actions. That's bad. But this says it's beyond that. You were dead. You were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. So they weren't like dead, right? Dead, flatline dead with no heartbeat, right? They were living. To me, I've always thought of this as, okay, so you're just existing. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to exist. I did a lot of years of existing, just like cruising through life with no meaning, no purpose, no goal, no objective, no nothing. Just wake up, go to work, have a few drinks, go to bed. Like, that was my life. Okay, yeah, and that's, I mean, that's awful. I just don't know that when your mommy held you in your arms and looked at you with such love and so many big dreams for your life, that you would wake up one day just like in a drunken stupor, or maybe you're not in some drunken stupor laying in the bushes like I was. Maybe you just have this lame job that just takes over your whole life, and you just want to work for a paycheck, and that's the only, and you don't spend any time with your family, and you don't have any relationships that have any meaning, and you're not doing anything that has any purpose. You're just punching a clock. Like, I don't think, I mean, I have little babies now, so when I look at little Jackson, I'm like, he's going to be a preacher, but I've already decided that. But I want him to do great things, or I want God to use him for great things, you know what I mean? So the kid would have some purpose. Like, there's a reason. I mean, you look at him, to me, he's absolutely stunning. Like, God put a lot into this little kid, you know what I'm saying? Like, he invested a lot of his beauty into this child, and I want him to utilize all that God has given him to do something amazing with his life, not just to have some lame life. I don't want him to just exist. I don't want to just exist. I don't want to just exist. I want to live a life of purpose. And so this Bible here is telling us that all of us, it's going to go on to say that we were dead, that we were just existing. And that's not the way God wants you to live. It says here, he kind of clarifies what it means to be dead. You used to live in sin just like the rest of the world. That doesn't exclude anybody, does it? So we go back to that. We used to sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to be that way. Now that says it all right there, man. All of us. He said every single one of us used to be that way, following the devil, refusing to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger. I don't even like that one. Most translations say wrath. And you know what? I don't know that anybody can give a clear definition as to what his wrath is, because we're not going to get wrath here to be able to report it. I just know one thing. It ain't good. Anyone want God's wrath? It's not good to fall into the hands of God that way, right? I don't know what it is, but I don't want it. His wrath would be bad. Oh, so by our very nature, we were subject to God's wrath just like everyone else. Everyone. But God, that's a great, you know, I love that, right? But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved. For he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms, because we are united with Christ Jesus. So God can point to us in all future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness toward us, as shown in all he has done for us who are united in Christ Jesus. God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. This is the gospel in a nutshell. None of us asked for it. None of us earned it. You didn't do it. He said, because he loves you, he did it. That's amazing. He did something for you even though you were his enemy, even though you were dead. How can a dead person ask for anything? Can a dead person ask for anything? Like, I don't know if anyone's wrapped their brain around this, that you were dead. You couldn't ask for a single thing. But Jesus loves you so much that even though you're dead and you didn't ask for it, he gave it to you anyway, and now you have life. Now you have life. Life is God-given. It's nothing you did to earn it. You didn't ask for it and you didn't earn it. And it says, and this is a universal indictment, it says that all of us used to be this way. Every single person that is a Christian now was dead and never even asked for it. He pursued you relentlessly till you finally just said, okay, I believe it. And he gave you life. You didn't ask for it. And it says now, because he loves you, that he has seated you in the heavenly realms because of what Jesus Christ has done, salvation isn't a reward for the good things we've done. So this is what happens. This is the normal progression, I think. Well, I'm insane, so maybe you guys don't think this way, but my normal progression was, okay, so if salvation is of God, not of me, right? If I can't save myself, so now I get this whole thing about what he says in Colossians I've shared with you the last 2 weeks about, so now just as you accepted him, so walk in him. Like that's what Paul's struggling with here, and he's trying to tell you, you're struggling with it too, because you all said you make bad choices, you know what you should do, but you don't. Now if you couldn't save yourself, what makes you think you could save yourself in your situation that you're in right now? And that's why Paul's going, listen, I can't make a good choice. I can't make a good choice of my own. So how did you come to Jesus? So that's what you got to do. You got to think about, how did you come to Jesus? Because before you can walk in him every day to help you with your decisions and choices and all that kind of stuff, the things I don't want to do but I do, and the things I do want to do, I don't, how do you get help with that? Just as you accepted him, so walk in him. What does that mean? It's just a good little Bible term. You come to him repenting. You come to him humble, right? You come to him leaning on him, depending on him. I need you to save me. I can't save myself, right? And I believe in you and I trust you. Same thing every day. So that's why he says that the answer to my problem, to my everyday need for salvation in the moment, is the same now as it was then. Jesus, I can't do this on my own and I need you to help me. I need to make a practice of repentance. I need to make a practice of leaning on him and trusting him and believing. And you have to do this every single day. Otherwise, that's why he says it's in Christ that the answer is. Otherwise, you fail. So it's not me. It's God who saved me. And it's God who will save me now in the current situation. And so that's why you see here, if you go back to the text, that's what Paul's talking about. In 24 and 20 and 25, he says, oh, what a miserable person I am. And you know what? Before you were a Christian and you didn't even care, you did wrong and it didn't bug you, did it? It's like no big deal. The only thing that really bothered you is maybe if you got caught. That would be bad, right? But you didn't really care. And what Paul's saying here is that I still make mistakes. I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do, but I'm miserable. He's miserable because now he knows it's bothering him. You guys all feel it, right? I know everyone in this room now. This is family here tonight. There's no guests. I know you all, and you all know this stuff. And so I know that you're just like Paul. It bothers you when you do something wrong because the Holy Spirit of God now lives inside of you. He's written his laws on your heart. And so when you are about to do something, it bugs you. And that's what Paul's experiencing right here, is that I am miserable because I know to do good and I don't. But I can help with this. I'm not by myself. Jesus promises that he would be with me. And I don't want to do this myself because every time I do it myself, it reminds me of just how exhausted I am of trying. You look behind your life and you see a trail of broken bodies, right? Failures, dreams that you had that just absolutely were a bust, relationships that are destroyed, financial stuff, foreclosures and bankruptcies and all these plans that we have that fail all the time because we're trying to do stuff. It's exhausting. And we feel like we have no hope. But Paul says there is hope for this, that I can stop making these bad choices if I will do as I did when I got saved, and that is to come to Jesus with my situation at hand and be repenting, leaning, and trusting, and asking him, in humility, please help me in this situation. And I see this all the time in church, people falling guilty, and they're guilty of this. They fall victim to this all the time. They come in here, they get saved, right? They get baptized, and they need him. They realize that they need Jesus because their life is, they come in here, and some lunatic gets up here and tells them that they suck, and they need Jesus, and all that stuff. That's great. That was Kyle, not me. And so, but they get saved, right? And then all of a sudden, what happens? You don't see him anymore. You don't see him at church anymore. And so they quit coming to church. They slow down their prayer life, and they quit giving. All these things that you know you should do to really ramp up your faith and keep you strong, keep you going, right? And they just adopt this attitude. Now that they got saved, well, I got this, you know? I got this. If I'm just a good guy, and I cut down smoking, and I cut down drinking, and I cut down on the amount of ladies that I sleep with, I'll be okay. I'll just be good. I'll try hard. I'll be honest. And it just doesn't work. The gospel has to continue. It's not just to get you saved from hell. It's an ongoing thing, and Paul's telling us this in this text, that it's a miserable life I'm living in my situation now, my choices now, my actions now. But who can save me from those? Jesus. Just like he did way back when with my biggest problem, when I was utterly helpless to help myself, he came and died to save me. And Paul's saying, listen, it's that same Jesus. It's that same Jesus who can come and help you. Look over in Galatians chapter 3. And look, this is not a new problem. It's been going on forever. This church here in Galatia, they're going through the same thing. They have these same problems. And somehow, some way, we fall victim of this philosophy, especially here in America, of just do good. I don't understand where that comes from. I don't get it. It's not in any book. It's not in any book to just be good. Being good means you're God, because it's up to you. What if your be good is different than my be good? We got a problem, right? That's a problem. What if you think that you have to do a certain amount of good things and Robert thinks he has to do a certain amount of good things? Who's right? Who's wrong? I don't know, but I'll tell you one thing. I don't want to live that way. I don't want to live in doubt. I don't want to have to toe the line and walk on eggshells and tiptoe through the tulips to try to figure out whether I'm good enough to have God love me and allow me into heaven. That's just not a good philosophy. It's terrible. And so Paul says this to the people over in Galatia. And it's not Galatia chapter 3, it's Galatians, for all of you waiting for me to do that. This is what it says in this book, same guy, same Spirit of God working through him to give him the words. These people came, he wrote to a church, right? So they're saved, they came to the cross, they were humble, they repented of their sin, they embraced Christ by faith, they believe. And so what does he say? Oh, foolish Galatians. Who has cast an evil spell on you? For the meaning of Christ's death was made as clear to you as if you had seen a picture of his death on the cross. So he's saying, like, I've come to you, and I've shared the gospel with you, and then I've appointed leaders in your church that have shared the clear picture, so much so of what happened, that you it was like you were there. Do you understood it? You got it. So what's wrong with you? Why all of a sudden has something changed? And it's the same thing here in this room. Every one of you, I know if you've been coming to this church, you have heard the gospel of Christ. You know it's not up to you to be saved. You know you didn't ask for it. You know you didn't earn it. But God loves you, and he gives himself for you on the cross to pay for your sins so you can be with him forever. You've heard it a million times. It never gets old. That was a good spot too. You guys need training. Listen. So listen, he says, oh, foolish Galatians, who has cast an evil spell on you? For the meaning of Jesus Christ's death was made as clear to you as if you had seen a picture of his death on the cross. Let me ask you this one question. I got to pause there. Paul's a preacher. Okay, so when he says he's going to ask, that's funny. That's Bible humor. Okay, if you want to count, there's six coming. Okay, now you know where I get this. It's not my fault. It's biblical. Okay. So when I say later on that I'm just about done, just turn your notebook to the next page, okay? I'm just kidding. So let me ask you this one question. Not really. Did you receive the Holy Spirit by obeying the law of Moses? Of course not. Exclamation point. So that's a big deal. You received the Spirit because you believed the message you heard about Christ. How foolish can you be after starting your Christian lives in the Spirit? Why are you now trying to become perfect by your own human effort? And I'm telling you right now, we do that same exact thing. I do it. I'm part of you. I'm part of the clan here, man. Telling you, no different than any of the rest of you. I do it. I got saved. I know I didn't save myself, but oftentimes I don't even think about praying. I don't even think of asking. Like when we built it, when we started doing this church, it was like, well, you know what? We're gonna start, so we gotta get some TVs, and we gotta have a youth pastor. I'm like, what? How do I know? I didn't even ask him. Well, that's what everybody else does. That's how you build a church. Well, no, not really. Why don't you ask me about what to do? Maybe that's what's wrong. Maybe we need to ask Jesus what to do around here. That'd be a good idea. Have a nice night. Right? I mean, seriously, though, like, we know we can't get saved on our own. I get that, right? It's not of your own accord that you got saved. I get that. But then day to day, and that's why I like the section with Paul, because, like, I know I got saved, but I'm still a total bust. I keep messing up. Why? Well, have you asked Jesus to help you in this one? Ask Jesus to help you in everything. Like someone who does that, we think they're weird. I think they're right. When I was at the car dealership, there was people that used to come in and say, before they signed the dotted line, they say, we need to go home and pray about it. That drove me crazy, right? Drove me crazy. It drove me crazy when I was a Christian that they did it. I should have been encouraging people to do it, right? Why wouldn't you? You're about to spend 20 G's? You darn right you better pray. Twice, three times, four times. Yeah, let's pray together. That's a joke. That's when you give them the old Baptist squeeze when you're trying to get them to believe, right? Give them the extra squeeze. What a joke. Yeah, that's what our managers used to do. Hey, pray with them. Yeah, sure. I don't want that bad vibe in my prayer life. We're victims of that. Speaking of cars, I mentioned this to you before. Jesus is saying, like, I gave you the title to the car. Why are you still making payments? You guys are going to need a bigger car now, aren't you? I just thought of that. They just got a car. Oh, that's funny. You want to pray? I know a nice yellow Volvo that's available. Yeah. You don't have enough money for it. So, but look, this happens. You can't get saved. You know you can't get saved. But then what he's saying here to the people in Galatians is the same thing that he'll say to you right now. Why is it that you, when you got saved, it was a spiritual thing. You gave it up. You said, God, I can't do it. I need to believe that Jesus went to the cross to pay for my sin. I got that, so I'm in. But then, what does it say? It says after you do that, then you're trying to be made perfect, like get better day to day to day to day to day by your own human effort. Why do we do that? So we seem to think that, okay, I'll accept Christ, I'm a Christian, but I just keep working on me, like a better me is going to make me perfect. A better me is going to make me more like Jesus. So I'll exercise some more, I'll eat some more broccoli and carrots, which I don't. But that's what people do. Maybe I'll get a tan. Maybe I'll get more educated. I'll get another degree. I'll buy Rosetta Stone and I'll learn like Spanish or something. I mean, or I'll learn how to play a guitar. That's a big one, right? But like, so it's a better me. I mean, that's what our whole culture is doing. Is you want to be a better you, like a better version of Moses is somehow going to get it done. So you go to the bookstore and it's from Oprah on down. They're telling you how to be a better you. Well, you can't because you're already a busted mess. And so sometimes people use religion, right? And we've talked about this before. They think that if they keep the rules, the thou shalt and thou shalt nots, and you keep them, you know, the letter of that somehow God will approve of you more. And well, this guy Paul, he said, listen, as to the law, I was perfect. I kept all the law perfectly, but I consider that garbage. He says in the Bible, I consider it dung, garbage, compared to the surpassing knowledge of knowing Jesus Christ as Lord. Not following the laws as the Lord of my life, that was kind of good, a shadow of a thing to come, but I consider that garbage compared to having Jesus showing me what to do and following his lead. So it's not about your own effort. See, here's the thing. I've heard so many people say this when it comes to salvation, right? That you know you can't trust your own human inclinations. You hear this all the time. Are you going to go to heaven? Oh, the things I've done. The things I've done. Somehow inside, whether it's if I'm good enough, I can get in, or whether I've been so bad that I can't, but both of them come from a broken idea system. Oh, the things I've done. As if that has anything to do. Well, it says that salvation is not a reward for the good things you've done. So it really is hell the gift for the things that you've done? If you're in Christ, we're going to see this in Romans 8. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. None of us are perfect here on this earth, but if you're in Christ, you're in the family. Do you understand? So it's not a matter of what you do or what you don't do. You do things and you don't do things because of your loving response to this incredible God who loved you so much that when you were evil and you were his enemy and you were dead, he gave you life. And the loving response to that is you follow his commands because you love him. That's the difference. Okay, that's the difference. It's totally different than what we normally do, this normal inclinations of our sinful nature. That's what we do. We respond with, oh, the things I've done. Or, oh, the things I've done, and I'm in. But it's not right. See, the Bible tells us a couple times in Proverbs, it says that there's a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it leads to death. It says it several times in Proverbs. I think it's in 14 and in 16. It says it several times. Why? Because there's just the way that we seem to do things that just fails. And you look behind you, like I said, you see a trail of disaster and failure behind you. But our normal response to all things of God is wrong. We saw that in Romans 1, that God makes all this stuff and it's beautiful. So what do? Oh, we worship that stuff. We make up some crazy whack job religion. None of us respond properly. There is a way that seems right, but in the end, it does lead to death. And God has, he's told us, he's put it down in writing, so we would know how to respond to him, so we would know how to worship him, so we would know how to follow him day in and day out. The answer, Paul says, to all of our problems day in and day out is found in Jesus Christ our Lord. Do you understand that we have to always be repenting? We can't just do it on the day we said yes to him. We need to break a practice of repentance. We need to constantly be leaning in on him and depending on him in our everyday situations, in our choices. I place before you blessings and curses, life and death. Now choose life. And none of us, including Paul who wrote the New Testament, he never chooses life. He always chooses bad. All of us raised our hand, right? Myself included. So he's given you the key right here. Just like you got saved, the same way you got saved, when you came to that altar that one day, humbly saying, I cannot do this myself, he said, come to that same Jesus with your situation, and I will lead you the right way. And then what? Then you choose life. That's what he's asked you to do. That's what he wants you to do with your lives every day, to live with intention. Don't just go around making choices, just following just the whim, the inclinations of your sinful nature. Because if you just respond and you don't think and you don't pray and you don't ask for guidance, you will inevitably, just like Paul, make a bad choice. Every one of us, thousands of them, right? Come on. Thousands of them. So what makes you think you can make a good choice today or ever, ever on your own without asking God to help us? The answer is in Jesus Christ our Lord. Do me a favor, go to Hebrews. We can, it is a special privilege to go to him and ask him for help. And you know, back in the day, they couldn't do that. They had this priest who would go in and ask God a question for you. And I think it was Kyle that told us that back in the day, and it's true, back in the day, the priest, they'd send him in there behind the curtain where God's manifest presence was, where you're not supposed to look upon it, and there's so much power there, they'd tie a rope to him. Because if he did anything that God didn't want him to do, he would croak, instantly dead, right? He's standing before perfection and holiness. And if you mess up in any way, he'll strike you dead. That's the God you serve, right? That's the one who loves you, right? So they'd have to pull him out with a rope because they didn't want to go in there. I ain't going in there, right? That's the way the priest would do it if he was from Umatilla. I ain't going in there, right? In Umatilla. How would they say it? I ain't going in there. I ain't going in there. Am I getting better? I ain't going in there. Heck no, I ain't going in there. How about that? Is that better? That's it. All right. So they pull him out, right? But now we don't have to do that. Look here in Hebrews chapter 10. I think this is the right spot. 10:23 starts here, and then we're going to go to Hebrews 4. Follow me down this road. I'll take you by the hand, and we're going to go down this road here in Hebrews. The writer of Hebrews says this, and I believe it's Paul. He says, let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep his promise. What was his promise? Protect, provide, be with you. He made a covenant with you, right? In Jesus, the blood on the altar. He promises. He says, hold on to this thing. But see, if you get it at the altar that day, and you turn your back and start trying on your own human effort, he's going, Patrick, this way. And you're not paying attention, what are you going to do? Make a mistake, just like Paul, right? So just hold on. He talks about this hope. What does it mean to hope? Is it, man, we're going fishing, we're going camping, I hope it doesn't rain. No say in it. I don't know. I hope it don't rain. That's not hope. That's a wish. Hope is confident expectation because he's proven himself a million times. You know God will deliver on his promises. That's real hope. And so the promise is, I'll be with you, I'll provide for you, I'll protect you, and you can come to me, go to Hebrews 4, and you can ask me in every situation, and I will help you. I will not leave you, he said, right? I will not leave you. I will be with you to the end of the age. And in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16, he gives us some really great news. He says, let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy. So in other words, he will not kill you even though you deserve it. He says, child, come on in and hang out with me. Right? He says, there you will receive his mercy and we will find grace. In other words, he'll give us stuff to help us even though you don't deserve it. Because that's just how wonderful he is. He just loves you and he wants to help you in your situations. He says, you will find grace there to help us when we need it most. And Paul, just like you, you're in that situation. I got a situation in front of me. What do I do? Left to my own accord, I'm going to make a mistake. There's a way that seems right to man, but the end, it leads to death. We all have the pile of bodies behind us, right? You all admitted it. You all admit that when I read that text, that you were like, that's me writing this. So don't make the same mistake again. Go before the throne of grace and mercy. You don't need to come to me and ask me to talk to God. You don't need to go to Kyle and ask him to talk to God for you. You just talk to God yourself, and you will receive the grace you need to get through that situation that you're faced with right then and there. Like, I don't know anybody, and maybe you guys can help me. I don't know anybody who truly follows the Spirit of God and leaves everything at the altar and prays all the time and asks for God's guidance that is just a wreck. Do you know anyone like that? An absolute failure who's just given their life day to day, moment to moment, situation to situation to Jesus in prayer. Do you know anyone like that that is a mess? I could ask that question at any church in the world and I'll get the same response. Nobody knows that guy because he doesn't exist. Things are good for the person who's in communication with the Lord all the time. Things are good. So, go back to that verse that we shared at the beginning. Romans 15, scriptures give us hope as we wait patiently for God's promises to be fulfilled. I don't know, I read that, I'm thinking back to that text now that we talked about here tonight, Romans 7, and I'm encouraged. I'm encouraged because I'm the same way Paul is. I've made bad choice after bad choice after bad choice, but I know that if I come to Christ humbly, repenting of my mistakes, asking for guidance, I know that if I can hold on and not waver, and he will fulfill his promise to protect, to provide, and to be with me in all things. And so I just encourage you the same way. And I'll close with this. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. He says one last thing. He says this, and then we're going to pray and we'll be taking communion together as a family. He says to these folks, so Christ has truly set us free. Right? You're free. He has paid. Yeah, there you go. He has paid the just requirement of the law. It's done. He also made a promise to you that he'll be with you, and if you'll come to him boldly, he'll help you. Paul says that he makes bad choices every single day, but there's help from this miserable life of torment because you know to do good and you don't. He says, so Christ has truly set us free. Now make sure that you stay free and don't get tied up again in slavery to the law. And he could have easily just closed by saying, don't get caught up again in your own human effort. Just as you came to Christ, so walk in him. I don't know about you, but I'm encouraged because I keep thinking back to the fact that I know Paul's going to be in heaven. And I also know that there's no such thing as a perfect Christian. They just don't exist. But I do know that there's people that love God. And they hunker down in prayer. And they ask God for help. And they include him in everything that they do every day. And I just would pray that that would be this church. That you guys would be those people. That would come to him every single day in all of your situations. Just like you did the day you gave your life to him for salvation. That you wouldn't make any more choices on your own, just in response, quick, to a situation that comes up. That you would take it to the Lord in prayer and let him guide you. And just remember this, no human effort ever, ever will make God love you more than he does right now. And no human effort, even if it's a bust, will have him love you any less than he does right now. His love is perfect and complete right now. I'm going to ask the guys who are going to give out communion to please come up and stand with me. We're going to pray, and then they're going to hand out communion to you. And while they are handing it out, I just want you to think about what you heard tonight. If you were looking to hear from God, I hope that with all the scripture that we shared, you heard from him tonight. And I hope that he'll minister to you. And I just want you to take a few moments to just think about this just requirement of the law, where Jesus laid down his life to pay for your sin. And then when everyone gets communion, we'll all take it together, okay? Let's pray. Father, thank you for letting us gather here tonight. Thank you so much for sending your son Jesus to do just that, to take care of the just requirement of the law. That you said that even though we don't like it sometimes, it says that without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sin. And so you just took it upon yourself to take care of that for us. And so we're very, very appreciative of that. Lord, there's a prevailing attitude in our country, and I'm not quite sure if it's in this church or not, but somehow, some way, we're like the folks in Galatia, that we came to you when we realized we couldn't have heaven on our own accord, and so we came to you and we asked you to help us, and we accepted what you did on the cross for our salvation, but yet we continue after that day to move on in our own strength and to do things without first talking to you and asking if this is really what you want for us to do. Lord, we know that all things work out for the good to those who love you and are called to your purpose. Like, we've heard that, but yet we don't make a practice of that. And so I pray that, Father, you'd help us to do that, to make a practice of including you in all the things that we do. Because it is miserable to know what to do, not do it. It brings guilt and shame, and we don't want to experience that. That's not what you want for us. You want us to live a life of victory, and joy, and peace. So help us to not make choices that lead down a bad road. Help us to include you in all the things that we do, to not lean on our own understanding, but to acknowledge you in all things so you would direct our paths. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.